Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. My name is Tracy Peterson, and I manage the United Nations Education Outreach Program in the Outreach Division of the Department of Global Communications. I'm very pleased to welcome you to this discussion today, which is organized by the United Nations Outreach Program on Slavery and the Transatlantic Slave Trade, together with the Permanent Mission of Senegal, and it's organized under the theme Ending Slavery's Legacy of Racism, a Global Imperative for Justice. The theme reflects the global movement to end injustices whose roots lie in the slave trade. The theme highlights the importance of educating about the history of the transatlantic slave trade and slavery to bring about an acknowledgement of slavery's impact on the modern world and action to address its long-lasting effects. The theme guides the program's development of educational outreach and remembrance to mobilize action against prejudice, racism, and injustice. Yesterday, the United Nations General Assembly marked the International Day of Remembrance of the Victims of Slavery and the Transatlantic Slave Trade. Today, we come together with a distinguished panel to discuss how Senegal has memorialized this tragic history and its plans to combine memorialization, education, and development. We invite you to join the discussion by sharing your questions and comments in the Q&A section that is open. Please include your name and the country from where you hail. And we are recording today's program and will make the recording available. But I would now like to turn to our next guest, who is Professor Jeremy Levitt. And Professor Jeremy Levitt is the Distinguished Professor of International Law at Florida A&M University College of Law. Professor Levitt, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much. And I bring greetings, not just for myself, but for the thousands of people that I represent as a change leader in the United States, and certainly as a professor at the nation's largest historically Black university. His Excellency, distinguished guests, my dear brother Malik and brother Coley, who I was with just a year ago, I welcome you. And my job is to provoke and to bring you a different type of conversation. Terminology is very important. And as someone who is a fifth generation descendant of someone who was enslaved, in fact, a man and a woman, I come from a certain particular perspective when it comes to Senegal, a country that I love and have been visiting as a brother and as a scholar and as a family member for 30 years. I see my talk today as an extension of the work of Reverend Leon Sullivan, Kwame Ture, Dr. Martin Luther King, Harriet Tubman, Sojourner Truth, and many others who have been involved with Pan-African movements. It's extension of the work of W.E.B. Du Bois, who chose Ghana in 1957 to locate himself and his family in the work. So if I provoke you, I have done my job. If I say something that you don't like, it's not attributed to Florida A&M University. If I say something that you do like, it is attributed to Florida A&M University. Let me just say the world has changed since 1986 when the conception of the memorial was created. So the context of the memorial has to also evolve and change. This was conceived during the Cold War when the OAU was new, before the African Union was created, before women actually were participants in the process of the conception of the memorial. And I want to say at the outset, there is no memorial without a recognition of the critical role that women have played, not just in mass movements, But in their victimization in not just the slave trade, but domestic slavery, it was the commodification of the woman, of the Black woman, that we have to pay attention and respect to as we conceive of how we move forward. I don't see the Gore Memorial as just a memorial. In fact, if I were to rename it, if you were to ask me my opinion, if you cared about what I thought as a descendant and a leader, I would say that it should be the Gore Memorial for racial justice. We're in a new time. We won the slave war. We're here. We have returned, and we're wanting to return, but wanting the policies that allow us to return with the dignity and strength. One in four of us survived. So if you look at that attrition rate, as Sister Candy has mentioned, we come back with a certain sense of strength, having not just won the war over the slave trade, but over enslavement in America, certainly Jim Crow segregation. And as you saw on January 6th, we're still fighting a war against white supremacy and colonialism and neocolonialism and imperialism and those forces of white supremacy and domination that are responsible for the slave trade, that gave it its justification, both in policy and in the religious context. So when we look at the purpose, it is to promote human rights. This is the original context of Gore Memorial, to promote human rights and international understanding. It's supposed to be a place of remembrance and of inward reflection, of mediation, of unity between Blacks in the diaspora and Blacks in the continent, the strengthening of our cultural identity, the cultural identity of Black peoples. It's supposed to be a hub of research and combating racial and cultural prejudice, right, that gave rise to the evils of slavery. The same evils that gave rise to slavery gave rise to the insurrection in America on January 6th. It says that it's to construct the defenses of peace in the minds of men, and we have to amend that to be the minds of women and men. It says not just a work of architecture, but a center for inter-African culture activities in unity with the diaspora. Well, what does that mean? What does that unity mean? Much of the dialogue of the Gore Memorial has not included African Americans. It needs to. It must. It has no credibility without African Americans. And despite all other diasporans throughout the world, from Brazil to Colombia to Mexico, African Americans are the most influential and powerful diaspora group. So we have to include this constituency because nothing moves in the diaspora without us being a part of it. We lead. And as you will find out in a moment, I'll speak to that in economic terms, because sometimes we have to empiricize the arguments that we make. But what does a right to return mean? There is not a single African country that, as a matter of national policy, has a right of return of Blacks in the diaspora to return with full citizenship based solely on ancestry and ethnic affinity. Ghana doesn't have it. It has a right to abode. And Nana Akufo-Addo, the president, His Excellency, has opened up the doors of Ghana. But there is no national policy as such that is similar to what is in the state of Israel. There should be such a policy. We can help you conceive it and imagine what it should look like, taking in consideration issues of economic development and national security. Article 3 of the Protocol of the Amendments of the Constitutive Act of the African Union calls for the full participation of the African diaspora as an important part of our continent. But what does that mean in the context of the Gore Memorial? I want to just take a rabbit path, as we say here, and just say, even the conception of names is important. I've spoken to Brother Coley in the past and want to bring this now to His Excellency and others. The term House of Slaves is a pejorative to the African-American mind, okay? It is not a progressive term. It is not a term that that will attract people. The House of Slaves for us has a connotation of the antebellum South, when we were called House and the N-word, and then you have slaves attached to it. It's like two pejoratives named after one another. And I might just forward the argument here that we were never slaves. And to even use the term is an insult. We were enslaved people. We launched 60 slave rebellions in this country not to be slaves. A slave is someone who is submitted to the will of a dominant force. Black people in the diaspora never submitted. This is why we launched revolution in Haiti. and in Colombia, in Mexico, and 60 rebellions in the United States. Why? Because we knew that we were Africans, and we knew that the basis of our enslavement was based on our Africanness. So to even call it a house of slaves, I think, is something that we need to revisit. And to refer to our ancestors as slaves is an insult. I never refer to my ancestors, those in my family who came through the transatlantic process, as slaves. Those are my ancestors. They were enslaved people, and they fought for their freedom. We have to begin and end the narrative now. This is not a question of academic debate, quite frankly. It is a question of reality and marketing if you want to attract the diaspora. We know that Senegal is emerging as a shining star in the constellation of African democracy, religious pluralism, and now Black empowerment. We know that the civil rights movement and those who led it are dying off. Those pioneers of the global Pan-African movement are dying. They're passing. They're going to the ancestral place. Who is going to carry the torch? We have to move quickly. We have to move with intention, because the generations that we have now, outside of the wokeness that has come with the murder of George Floyd and the global racial justice movement that has been launched, has reignited interest in these issues. But that interest was largely forgotten. That we have generations of Blacks in the diaspora and in the continent that are not connected in a way that they were connected 20 and 30 years ago. So we have to recontemplate a 21st century strategy of Pan-African engagement that harnesses sovereignty and culture and natural resources. We have to take Senegal's inherent qualities and combine them with the global political influence and economic power, for example, of Black America. I say to all that listen, as the diaspora ambassador for the Museum of Black Civilization in Dakar, Senegal, that Senegal's greatest natural resources is not oil and gas, but it's what I call the Black trifecta, which, when the memorial will be completed, will be the Black quartet. It sounds musical and it sounds educational, doesn't it? The Gori Island, the African Renaissance Monument, the Museum of Black Civilization, the Gori Memorial itself. These are pillars of investment by the Senegalese people for the diaspora. And we have to market it, and we have to have Senegal make its stake as the go-to place for the diaspora. There is no other African country, there's no country in the world, not even in America, that have made more investments in the Black diaspora as Senegal. And we have to say that, and we have to be intentional with it, but we also need the marketing and the strategy to ensure that these are just not monuments that sit and grow spider webs, but that collect dust, but that they're there for the diaspora to come in the continent to celebrate these monumental achievements that have come on the backs of the taxpayers of the Senegalese people. Senegal has to adopt a new strategic vision for engaging the diaspora, and it has to envision a paradigm that harnesses not just the transactional nature of what a relationship could be. Initially, Ghana looked at African Americans in the context of tourism, knowing that we have been there for 50 and 60 years living. We have thousands of African Americans in Ghana and thousands that live in South Africa. But why not Senegal? Why haven't the doors opened for us to come and to live and to invest and to work? And particularly in this new age since COVID, we know that we can work remotely, right? We make up 14% of the American population, roughly 42 million people, but no American president can be elected without the African American vote. No piece of legislation can pass through Congress without African American engagement. So we have to start looking at the political power just here in the United States. We need real and symbolic support of the millions of African Americans who are ready. We have to think out of the box. The French have done Alliance Francaise all over the world. But why don't we have Alliance Wolof in Black American cities, New York, Chicago, LA, Philadelphia, Houston, Detroit, Los Angeles, and Washington, D.C., where maybe as an extension of the Gori Memorial, we're investing in the training of African Americans in Wolof so that they can come to Senegal and speak the language of the people, right? This requires a different kind of thinking. We have African Americans learning French. They should be learning Wolof. Black Americans are the most prolific and influential consumers in the United States. Listen carefully. We spend $1.5 trillion in the U.S. economy every year. That's 71 times the gross domestic product of Senegal itself. If Senegal captured 1% of the African-American consumer spending, even 1% of our tourism dollars, which amount to $68 billion, it could revitalize the economy. But we're not interested, Mr. Ambassador, in a transactional relationship. We need a relationship that has true cultural and racial and political affinity. We know that the Ghanaians are trying. I think the Senegalese could potentially outpace them in the years to come. So I'll leave with just this notion. The Gori Memorial could stand as the beacon of light to connect with the diaspora, along with the other investments and infrastructure that Senegal has made. But without a policy of a right to return, without African Americans at the table helping to think and conceptualize what works for us, we will make no progress. And in 40 years, we'll be having the same discussion we're having now. I yield my time back to the chair.
Thank you, Professor Levitt. You said you were, your intention was to provoke, and you certainly have done that. And it is a great tradition of shaking the tree, of making, bringing up points that are challenging sometimes and people may not agree with, but it's really important to have those perspectives. And I was struck particularly about your, right at the end, you're talking about bringing African Americans to the table, the diaspora, involving the diaspora to the table. And I was wondering if you could perhaps share with us how you would imagine that table invite equally those of whose ancestors were enslaved and who live in Senegal. So how are you how do you envisage including equally the community voices and the local, non-governmental organizations, for example?
Well, let me, and thank you for the question. Let me say, I don't mind shaking the tree as long as it's a baobab tree. Let me say this, that you can't have a concept for a memorial. Even the Museum of Black Civilization has engaged the diaspora. I'm one of the people. The African Renaissance Fund, these incredible landmarks of the African diaspora, to conceptualize the marketing strategy, to conceptualize the diaspora angle to this is critically important. It is not something that someone who is not of the descendants of enslaved people can conceptualize, quite frankly. That input, it's kind of like, when I hear your question, it's kind of like, how can the UN negotiate a convention without women? When you include women in the discussion, you open up an entirely different paradox of understanding and contribution. Now here, it's the same thing. And not only do we need to include the diaspora, but we have to have gender diversity in that inclusion. Because as I said at the beginning, the Black woman's body was commodified. It was the means and mode of production. It was the engine of enslavement itself. And so when we talk about slavery and we start to look at how much people cost and how they were insured, the entire world has bloody hands. And part of the remembrance is not just to remember in a way that one is weeping about what happened, because we all weep when we come back to Gorée. But it's also to realize that we won the war and that we have a fight to continue, and we have to pursue this greater aim of racial justice. So that fight is a combined fight, and we're better off fighting it in unity than in our separate parts in the diaspora or the continent. So this is a policy question I'm raising. It's a question of vision that the leadership in Senegal have to realize. One, who they're dealing with when they deal with African Americans. I'm not so confident that some that have been gauged at the highest levels are the best people, because they're not people who understand the African American landscape from Main Street to Wall Street, number one. They're just political operatives sometimes that work for the U.S. government. Those are not sometimes the best people to be representing the Black masses, number one. Number two, I think that if we want to galvanize the interests of the diaspora and get African Americans and others in the diaspora to come, then we have to engage them in the reconceptualization of what all of this means. And that is, again, a policy decision that the leadership in Senegal has to have the foresight to say, we need these people involved and engaged for this to be a credible endeavor and for it to be successful. There is no success without more minds from the diaspora at the table.
I think you're being heard loud and clear, Professor Levitt, and your compassionate care about the success of this project, that it is not just a building, but that it represents not only the pain and the loss, but also that it stands to remind us all of the connections, of the ways in which you mentioned the word solidarity between the diaspora and those who are in Senegal. And also, I was just struck, I think we are all struck by how powerful your presentation is. And I think certainly I could imagine that it could not be ignored. So thank you very much, Professor Levitt. You will see as well that there are comments of support for the points that you raise. And we'll come back to you again and at the end of our talk
with one of the comments that we received from one of our attendees. It's Eureka from ADACI, says, "Dear panelists, I would like to urge you to please include diaspora organizations, civil society in the planning stages of the Gori Memorial. Many of us have been carrying this work for decades, and too often scholars neglect to see the significance of our work only when we are being used for research. Academic, civil society, and private sector is a critical partnership." And I was wondering, I think, Jeremy, that Professor Levitt, this is what you're bringing up as well. But I'm just wondering, where are people is there a place where people are indicating their interest? How are you going to manage to make sure that people all feel involved? I mean, obviously, logistically, it's not possible to have everybody's voices there, but how are you going to manage this passionate interest and desire to be involved?
Well, I'll leave some of that to Malik to answer, because he's with the memorial. But what I can say is I can help them think through how to do it. I think now there's a need to develop a mechanism that is sustainable. In the original documentation, there is a structure that is envisioned. That structure has been partially carried out and not carried out at the same time with the creation of different committees and bodies. But we need to re-envision that and create some pipelines where stakeholders can communicate, and that can be reviewed by committee members in a systematic fashion. This is something that we do in most large endeavors like this, and because this is global, it's very important that people feel like they're able to make a contribution, even if it's the submission of their thoughts from their organization and their institution. There's a lot of genius in the world, and so it's incumbent upon the memorial to develop the mechanism to have an intake process as things are developing. I do want to just, and I'll leave the rest for Malik to make reference to, but I do want to say two things that my colleague said that sparked my thought. First of all, sitting where I sit as someone from the diaspora, I visited Senegal for the first time in 1993 with 3,000 African Americans. It was under the leadership of Reverend Leon Sullivan. It was an emotional, painful experience. A year ago, Brother Coley, remember, I brought my daughter to Senegal. I've been coming for many years, but I brought her, and she broke down in the door of no return. It has an impact on us that it doesn't have on Europeans who are coming there for tourism and other Americans, and quite frankly, non-Blacks. It doesn't mean that they can't connect to the humanity of it. It's different. This is the ancestral place. So I think that as we think and we conceive, we have to also take in that at an emotive level, we all have very different responses to this. And that emotive, that social psychology has to be built into the framework and structure of how we conduct our tours, how we open up the memorial, which vendors are going to be present at the memorial, whether it's the tip of the spear and what I'm calling the quartet, which is now a trifecta, or whether it will be something else. So I think it's important, and I say that to say that Mr. Coley and the other leaders of these institutions really have some of the most important jobs in the world, quite frankly. The pay may not reflect it, the thanks may not reflect it, but his job is one of the most important jobs in the world when it comes to the diaspora. And I want to just recognize him because I know his heart and I know his spirit. And I know the hard work he's trying to do at times, having to work through, the various bureaucratic institutions. So I just wanted to thank him personally for continuing to soldier on with this work. It's incredibly important. And to Sister Candy, I just want to say, you had mentioned something about name changes, and at the same time, you make a reference for the need to be detailed. And I just want to say, because it's important for people who may not be aware, most of the names that Blacks in America have, we didn't choose. They were chosen for us. They were chosen by law. The two names that we chose, and we don't have a reemergence into Black. Black has always been consistent. We had an entire Black Power movement. African-American really came to prominence with Jesse Jackson's runs for president in 1984, 1988. But Black has always been current. And if you look at the birth certificates of many of us born in a certain time, it's going to say Negro or it's going to say Black. But we had colored. And we had Afro-American, and we've had all kinds of various, various pejorative names. I would say when we begin to look at the history of those names, we've really been in the driver's seat for maybe two of them. And so there hasn't been necessarily a change. There was a change in the terms of how the movement, the Black Lives Matter movement, was designated. And part of the reason for that is there's a recognition that sometimes the term African-American means the traditional descendants of the transatlantic process, where we have Blacks from all over the world here, from the Caribbean, as you know, from the Americas, from the continent. We want to be inclusive and making sure that all of those individuals feel like they have a home in the human rights movement, that is the Black Lives Matter movement. So I just wanted to clarify that. I think you know all of those things, but for the purpose of our listeners, I wanted to clarify, because it's incredibly important that the Gorey Memorial be perceived as a place for the Black diaspora. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Leavitt.